So energy is obviously the ability for an object to walk, and it is it represents the state of a system. So here we are going to look at the strain energy and complementary strain energy. So here we have a representation of a unit cube, which is being loaded or stressed, and we have the strain stress components on it. We have representation of stress tensor on the object. So it is the representation. So we know that when a load is applied onto an object, if it's not a rigid object, or if we don't keep the rigid body approximation, the body deforms, and the energy, the potential energy that is stored in the object is given by the product of force into displacement. If the load is suddenly applied, and if it's gradually applied, we will get something like half into load displacement. So in terms of stress and strain, the obvious relation is half into stress into strain. So that's what we have had here, that is this energy stored in the system per unit volume, that is rate. So the system is given by half into stress into strain. Okay. So for a three-dimensional object, we have the corresponding multiplication, we multiply it by the corresponding stress is multiplied by the corresponding strain, and we sum it over the entire domain. So we will get the elastic strain for the object. So this is, as we have, we can see here, this is for unit volume. So if we want to find the energy stored in the entire object, we have to integrate it over the volume. We have this integral dx by dz for a Cartesian object. We have integrated over dx by dz and over the volume. So if we go for a two-dimensional approach, simply we have axial loading and shear loading. So this entire thing reduces to this form. That is, although we have the volume term here. Although we have the volume term here, some of the parameters will be constant. So obviously, in Hooke's law, or the proportionality domain, we have the strain and stress is proportional. Or if we apply load, the deflection is proportional. So we have this relation. So applying this relation into the upper equation, we get something like this. So we have reduced the above equation into a single parameter equation, in which here we have stress. We can have a single equation in terms of strain. So this is the strain energy for a two-dimensional object. So if we go for a object which is loaded only in one direction, one type of load, we can reduce the above equation further, and we will get something like, say, if we have an axial load, so we have a bar here, whose cross-section area is A, and it is being loaded by a load P. So it obviously it will have stress and strain. We'll consider a small infinitesimal section of length dx, and we'll see what the amount of energy stored in it is. So we'll have from the above equation this integral over the volume sigma axis, that is if we take this direction, that is the direction which the load is applied as x. Take this direction as x, we'll have integral over the volume sigma x square by 2 e, e is Young's modulus into volume. Volume can be written as a product of area and length. So here, in this step, we have divided this integral over the domain of length and area. So everything in this term, yeah, area is a constant because obviously it's not going to be. So we can take it out of the integral, and if we integrate dA, dx over the area, we will have A, and area will cancel out. And we will be left with the strain energy is equal to B square A by 2A. This is for axial load. Likewise, similarly for object bending, a beam bending, say if we have a beam, which is being loaded by say either a load P, say in this case for a moment. We have the relationship between stress and momentum, sigma is equal to m by pi I. So substituting that, we will have, can take out m, y, I and e, to everything out of this equation. So we can't take y out, so m square by 2 I e out. So we have something like this. In this term, these things are constant, and y square d will give us the second integral area, which is called as the area moment. So obviously these two terms, that is ixx and ixx square, cancel each other, so we get something like integral over the length m square 2i, m square by 2i. Into, if we integrate this side, we will get m square n by 2i. Similarly for strain energy for beam shear, we will have similar equations. Likewise for circular tubes and torsion. So in this we will have this equation, that is a torsion equation. Sigma x by r x y by r is equal to d by ip. Ip is the polar moment of inertia. Applying this equation, we will have t square r by 2 gp I square d dx. And here we have, from this equation, that is polar moment of inertia is defined as the integral over the area of dr. The polar moment of inertia is not. Square d is equal to half power of inertia. Hence, we will be left out with d square by 2 g I p dx. So, these all terms are constant. So, we will be left with d square 2 g I p into l. That p is the torque. Thank you, I hope you can understand this.